Hello friends, let's now try to understand the drivers on the business side that are driving the growth of FinTech. So what's driving the growth of FinTech so extensively? And will these drivers continue to make sure that the FinTech grows in future? Also, why should I know about these drivers? How is it going to help me in my career? Fundamentally, it is the business that drives the technology. A lot of innovation on the technology side has happened because, you know, business has been demanding newer and newer ways of serving the customer. Businesses serves human, technology serves the business, and therefore business demand drives the technology. That has been the paradigm for quite some time. Now, of course, in FinTech, we are seeing that the technology is also driving the business in a big way. In the area of FinTech, specifically, finance has driven technology, and today even technology is driving the business. What are the key business drivers driving the technology? Let me first list those down for you. Number one business driver is venture capital and private equity investing, which has been growing a lot in the FinTech area. Number two is the changing customer preferences and demands. For example, customers requiring 24/7 availability, online delivery, maybe using mobile as a device, and also preference for the paperless transactions. The third factor is the intellectual property laws, which support the innovation in a big way. The fourth factor has been the new business models which have evolved, which have made the FinTech businesses very profitable. The fifth is the ecosystem approach which FinTech companies have successfully taken, which has helped them grow. The sixth is the potential of the FinTech to serve the underserved market, which otherwise was getting left out of the banking and other services. The seventh is the regulatory focus on FinTech, which has helped nurture the growth of the FinTech in the right kind of way. Let's discuss now each of them in detail. The first factor driving FinTech has been the venture capital and private equity investment. As we know, in the funding cycle, we initially have the promoters of the founding putting up the money required to start the company. Then there could be angel investors and seed investors who will support them in the very nascent stage. And then there are micro VCs and VCs, the micro venture capitalists and the venture capitalists who come in. And these are the big money guys who typically put in, you know, at least $500,000 or $1 million plus kind of checks. And then they have very high expectations. Obviously, they are putting in money at a stage where the business has much more risk, right? The business model is not completely established. So they have high expectations of returns, like maybe expecting to exit at 10x, 20x. But they do also add a lot of value. They put in a lot of funding. They add value, for example, like guiding the founders, promoters, and management, maybe appointing key people on the board, maybe helping them with the other portfolio companies in the group, maybe helping them pilot, maybe helping them implement, so on and so forth. And a lot of these private equity and venture capitalists are run by people who have the global outlook. Maybe they have worked extensively abroad, maybe they are located abroad, so that they have different kind of a mindset and a lot of value add they can do for your company. In India, FinTech has been one of the domains which has received a lot of investment from the VC and PE players. I think it's number two after e-commerce. And this growth in the investment has been almost four times in last couple of years. Right? So I'll later discuss the numbers in detail. So one of the important factors, as I said, number one has been the venture capital and PE investment in the FinTech area, which has driven the growth extension. The second factor which has driven the growth of FinTech companies is the changing customer preferences. Today's customer, typically a young generation, is looking at services available 24/7. If I want to, you know, transfer money to my friend, let's say at 1 p.m. or 1 a.m. in the night, then in that case, I want that option available to me, which means that, you know, through mobile, for example, I should be able to execute that transaction. Also, today's generation expects most of the transactions to be paperless. Nobody wants to be involved in extensive documentation, you know, processing and also storing those documents somewhere. But we want audit trail. We want to be able to go back and look at the transactions that I have done. And, you know, all these FinTech apps or business models support that, because there's a regulation also requiring them to do that. And people also want many times a faceless comfort. You know, you don't have to go to the bank, talk to people extensively, spend time in commuting, right? And if something can be done online quickly, you know, by interacting through app, for example, if my KYC can be done simply by uploading a video, right, for opening a bank account, you know, this is what I desire, right? So these kind of changing customer preferences is the second most important factor which has driven the growth of FinTech. The third factor has been the improvement in the IP protection laws or the intellectual property protection laws, because FinTech is, you know, extensively IP driven, right? So you innovate, you create something new, and you just simply cannot have me too or the clones coming up and, you know, benefiting from what effort you have undertaken, the investment you have made, and, you know, maybe doing better and killing your idea in the process. So improved IP laws is something which has extensively helped a lot of new age companies grow, and FinTech has been one of the biggest beneficiaries of that. The fourth important factor that has contributed to the growth of FinTech is the new revenue models which have come up, right? So once you acquire the customer, for example, you can give him the services for free for some time, which is classically called a freemium model. So you might give some services for free all the time, or maybe all services free for some time, right? So this is typically how freemium models are designed. You can give options to the customers to subscribe, for example, on a monthly basis and maybe on an annual basis with some kind of discounts to incentivize the customer to go for the annual basis. You can price based on number of users. You can price based on usage or number of transactions, what is classically called a pay-per-drink kind of a model. And these revenue models can be set up. There are companies in the payment space which also have the modules which help you set up these kind of models without having to invest in, you know, separate technology. Many of these companies are using the revenue model of customer as a data, right? So for example, if you look at Cred, which is one of the unicorns from India, they are not making any profit, but the valuation is $1 billion plus, which makes it a unicorn, because they are getting the private and sensitive data of the customers around their credit card spend, which is going to be extremely valuable. And I think today more than 50% of India's customers, credit card users, are using Cred. So they are sitting on a gold mine of customer data that, you know, they can leverage in different ways tomorrow. Also, many of these companies convert their, you know, revenues into MRR, ARR kind of sort of projections, where they can get very high valuations. For example, the monthly recurring revenue, right? If it is very high, or if the annual recurring revenue is high, then that is what the VCs and PEs, etc., prefer from the valuation point of view. So these new revenue models have helped FinTech companies grow very, very fast. Fifth important factor that has helped FinTech companies is the ecosystems approach that these companies take at times. So for example, in this entire ecosystem, there is, of course, government, RBI and other regulators have been supporting these new companies extensively. The regulations have been, you know, relatively sort of, you know, startup friendly. Startup India initiative, etc., has helped these companies, for example, you know, sort of get their IPs registered relatively cheaply, maybe, you know, sort of give them tax holidays, you know, they can benefit and grow for some time initially. The technology firms in this area, for example, have supported FinTech. They have set up separate teams, models, you know, for helping them do product engineering. Academia has got involved in FinTech big time. You will see a lot of academics from leading business schools, technology, you know, like IITs and others, getting involved in FinTech, writing research papers, helping them come up with ideas and so on and so forth. Banks, financial institutions, the corporates, they have been helping these companies through seed investments, through piloting of their projects, for example, helping them with the data. There are lawyer firms, chartered accountancy firms, the company secretaries, etc., which have helped them through maybe helping with the IP registrations, maybe setting up the companies and so on and so forth. And they have involved models specifically that help startups and these kind of FinTech companies. The entire investing community, right from the, you know, the angel and seed investing on to micro VCs, VCs, PEs, etc., they have, you know, looked at this sector very, very favorably because of the huge potential for growth, right? And the FinTech community has, you know, I must say, extensively networked with all these kind of ecosystem players, along with the ultimately the consumers, right, or the businesses and entrepreneurs who are going to consume those services. And, you know, they have, this is one of the factors that has helped the FinTech companies grow quite a lot. One more factor which has helped FinTech grow is the potential of serving the underserved market. So, you know, if you are looking at, let's say, providing banking services or insurance services to people in remote areas, for example, hilly areas where there are very few people, they do not have that much of a spending power, for example, right? So it is very cost driven, right? So costs are very high if you want to provide. Of course, Government of India has been focusing on them and sort of incentivize at least the public sector banks in going and set up branches in rural areas, etc. But still, there's a limitation of the kind of services you can provide. So this bottom of the pyramid kind of a population, which is huge in India as an example, that has been served and targeted by FinTech very, very successfully. So they are able to do this last mile delivery through right kind of authentication. So for example, Government of India through Aadhaar has enabled Aadhaar, you know, based authentications. So they are using payments, for example, by using this. They are distributing insurance products by using this, and all at a low cost, right? So this potential of serving the underserved market is something that has helped FinTech grow tremendously. One more factor for FinTech growth has been the regulatory focus. So as I said, you know, government initiatives, for example, like Startup India and others, the RBI, for example, the way they have enabled the FinTech growth, right? And they have sort of slowly tightened the norms, of course, you know, for example, RBI's directives on peer-to-peer lending, etc., have been coming at the right time, I must say, or, you know, Government of India's regulation around cryptocurrency, right, which is extremely speculative in my opinion, right? So that focus has been right, which has helped the FinTechs grow quite a lot. FinTechs have to maybe go for the NBFC licensing if you are, for example, you're into lending, but app-based lending also still you have to be a NBFC. You have to comply with a lot of regulations around, you know, KYC, for example, know your customer, anti-money laundering. If you are dealing with, let's say, US customers, you have to comply with Banking Secrecy Act in US as an example, right? All those you have to take care of. You have to ensure the data privacy of the customer. You have to make sure that your IP is getting protected, and also, you know, you have to make sure that the cyber security standards are complied with. So regulation has, you know, sort of been evolving in this area. I must say a lot of things still need to be done, but that has helped FinTech companies grow extensively, because with unless there is a right amount of regulation, there may be some place in the market which will exploit that, in the manner which they should not, and then the sector will suffer. But regulatory focus has been really good in the FinTech area. So all these have helped FinTech grow quite a lot in last about 2 decades. I will talk about modern FinTech, which has grown in last about 2 decades. So understanding what is driving this change will help you identify the growth areas in FinTech, you know, what kind of roles and careers you should look for, what kind of skills are required, and then how do you go about acquiring those skills. This will help you get a great career in the area of FinTech. I hope you found this video very interesting and useful. If yes, please do like this video, share with your friends who will benefit from this, and also do subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much. Yes.